Hi, this is Dr. Chaffee. Today I just wanted to talk a bit about digestion. Everyone talks about the differences between different animals and their digestion. They say, well, humans are herbivores because we have digestion like a cow, or an herbivore, this, that, and the other, or we're a carnivore because of, you know, the same arguments. But no one really knows exactly what means anything, and what the main principles are and what the main points are. So when you're having these discussions, here are some of the main points. So we are primates, okay? So we have a primate digestion, okay? So we're gonna have adaptations in one direction or another, but they're fundamentally going to be primate. So they're gonna be very similar to a gorilla or a chimpanzee or a tarsi or something like that. But we're gonna be having some subtle differences. So people think that because we have a similar digestion to other primates, that must mean that we're herbivores like those herbivorous primates, but not all primates are herbivorous. And, you know, so that really doesn't make a strong argument. We have some things that are very typical for carnivores. We have very low stomach pH, okay? So it actually goes down to around like 1.4, which is extremely, extremely acidic. And this is generally what we see with people, animals that are scavengers like vultures, okay? It's thought that early on in our meat-eating heritage, millions of years ago, that we were eating carrion, and we weren't able to take down and kill animals ourselves because we didn't have big teeth and claws, so we were actually eating the remains of what other animals left. And we were figuring out how to do that. We're getting smarter and using tools and, you know, using stones to crack open the skulls to get at the brains. And that was giving us nutrition. And we started figuring out other ways of using tools as well. And that's why our brains developed instead of our teeth and our claws. Okay. We also have very long small intestine. Okay. And this is where all the proteins and fats and other nutrients and vitamins all get absorbed. Okay. So we get a lot of the majority of our nutrition comes from there. The vast majority of what we eat gets absorbed in the small intestine, so we need a longer small intestine, just like other carnivores. Our large intestine is actually very small, so these things are a bit, you know, misnamed really, but, you know, small in the sense of length, not as diameter, which is why we call a large intestine large, because it's bigger diameter. So this is something that we don't really see in herbivores. Herbivores have a longer large intestine, and in fact, primates, when you look at them specifically, they are hindgut digesters if they're herbivores, okay? So they have a very long large intestine and a very long cecum, which helps them break down plant material and fiber, and actually get the majority of their nutrition comes from that breakdown of that fiber. Okay, so no vertebrate animal can break down fiber. Okay, so certain animals like a cow or like a gorilla have been able to basically farm bacteria that eat this fiber, and as a byproduct, basically their waste are short chain fatty acids, okay, which are saturated fats, are 100% saturated. And so that's what the animal actually absorbs, okay? So what they eat and what they put in their mouths is not the same thing as what they absorb, okay? What they absorb are these short chain fatty acids and proteins that are a byproduct of those bacteria eating fiber and breaking it down, okay? We can't do that. That's how you know we are not like other herbivorous primates, and we're not herbivorous because we lost that ability millions of years ago. We have an appendix. An appendix is a vestigial cecum, okay? In a gorilla or a chimpanzee, there's very long, like 4 foot long. Ours is about that big, okay? Vestigial, meaning that it's an organ that used to do something, now it does nothing, and it hasn't for millions of years because we haven't used it in millions of years, okay? And so the cecum, that blind outpouching, used to be where our ancestors would, you know, get their nutrition from fiber. And that's where gorillas and so forth, that's where that packs in and they break down that fiber and get the short chain fatty acids, okay? So we can't do that. We've lost that ability because we were eating meat for millions of years. And that's this further evidence that we're carnivores and that our ancestors and that we are who we are because our ancestors became carnivores millions of years ago. Okay. So, you know, all herbivores that eat fibrous plants are able to break down fiber to a certain extent. Okay. And we can't do that. So that is a cardinal feature of us not being herbivores. Okay. So the other issue is bile. This is something that comes up a lot. People talk about how, you know, if you eat meat or you eat fat, you're going to get gallstones. This is a supposition. This is something that has been bandied around because it sort of fit the, you know, the observable evidence, but it is completely and utterly wrong. Okay. So in medicine, we talk about the four F's for gallstones. These are risk factors. It's not a guarantee, but it's a risk factor. Female, fertile, 40s, fat. Okay. And fair is another one. You know, people of light complexion seem to get this stuff more often. But this is not one-to-one. They say, well, this person's fat, therefore, because they ate fat, they've gotten fat and they've gotten gallstones. But people don't get fat from eating fat. They get fat from eating carbohydrates and sugar. Okay, so it wasn't the fat in the first place that got them fat. But what you do see commonly in this thread of people, I mean, think about it. You have, you know, a lady who's in her 40s, just had a couple kids, has a little bit extra baby weight and wants to lose that weight. Okay, wants to get her body back. And so she goes on a diet. Well, what has everybody been told for the last 40 years is if you want to lose fat, you stop eating fat. And so these people want to lose this fat. They want to lose the baby weight. And so they stop eating fat. Okay, and that is actually the problem. Your body makes bile so that you can absorb fat. Okay, it's very difficult for your body to absorb fat without bile. There's some medium chain fatty acids which can just be absorbed on their own, but nearly all other fats need bile. It's very difficult for your body to absorb bile to absorb fat without bile. Okay, your body makes a certain amount of this. Okay, about 800 milliliters to a liter a day. And now, you know, maybe that can change depending on what you're eating and what your body requires and so forth. But there is a limit and there is a finite amount of bile that it makes. Okay, it's a slow process. This is made and then stored in your gallbladder. Okay, then when you eat fat, it squishes it out and your bile goes down, absorbs that fat. So, you know, I mean, as a side note, it's kind of ridiculous for people to argue that fat is bad for us if we have four organs working in concert just to absorb fat. Liver makes bile, your gallbladder stores it, your pancreas secretes enzymes to break it down, and your small intestine absorbs it into your body, okay? You know, that's a lot of energy for your body, and evolutionarily, biologically, you know, it doesn't make any sense for you to build that system and evolve that system if that wasn't really, really, really important, okay? Which it is, all right? So what happens to these people that get gallstones? Problem is they don't eat fat, right? If you were to eat as much fat as you had bile for, which I take to mean as much as your body wants, okay, then you're going to excrete all the bile that's in your gallbladder, right? Every day. So even if you were someone who had some weird condition that meant that you would get gallstones in just one day, you could never get gallstones if you were eating enough fat. You couldn't possibly, because the bile wouldn't be there in your gallbladder to form stones in the first place. Okay? It physically cannot take place if you're eating enough fat. Okay? So you get these people that go on a diet, stop eating fat. And then all of a sudden, 6 weeks later, 8 weeks later, when they go off the diet, all of a sudden they go, oh, that hurts, because now their body's trying to squish out the bile, but there are stones in it, and they get stuck, and that hurts. And they go to the doctor, and they say, it's because you're eating too much fat. Well, no, actually, it's because they weren't eating fat, okay? And they stopped eating fat, okay? Because your bile goes into your gallbladder, but it doesn't just run, you know, when it runs out of room, it doesn't just sit there, okay? It concentrates. Okay, not everyone knows this, but even in the textbook, it describes bile as being able to get up to 20 times more concentrated than when it originally comes out of the liver. So there may be people that get more concentrated than other people, and maybe those people are more predisposed to gallstones. Maybe that'd be interesting to look into, because certainly not everybody gets gallstones even if they just stop eating fat entirely. Okay, so there's probably something else going on as well. But you know, the take home is, if you eat enough fat, it doesn't matter, you cannot form stones. Okay, so bile goes into your gallbladder, it gets more and more concentrated, more and more concentrated. What happens to any hyperconcentrated solution at rest? It forms precipitates. It forms stones. Okay, that's what bile sludge is. That's what gallstones are. Okay, and you see this in bariatric medicine as well, because when people remove parts of the stomach and the lower intestine and the first part of the duodenum and the small intestine and so forth, or put in a sleeve and what have you, it was, you know, many different surgeries in that realm. But a lot of these people, much more than the rest of the population, even the overweight population, will develop gallstones. A lot of them do. Okay, and I've heard this described as, well, you know, something changes metabolically when you lose weight really fast, that somehow that makes you form these stones. Okay, maybe it does, but you still won't form stones if you get enough fat. And what is the commonality between these people? These people are really serious about losing weight. They really don't want to be overweight anymore. They're going through very dangerous, life-threatening surgery. It can threaten your life, and it can threaten your quality of life, and it can threaten your happiness going forward. I've seen several people that I know personally have had very bad results from this and have serious health issues afterwards. So this can seriously affect you. But they're very serious about this. And so what do? They're going to stop eating fat altogether. And I've heard people say this when they get gallstones. They say, you know, that can't be, because I have not eaten any fat in months. And, you know, to me, that's why they got gallstones. Okay. So it's not that they lost a lot of fat or lost a lot of weight quickly, it's how they lost a lot of weight quickly. It's by just completely eliminating fat altogether. Okay, so these are all things that point in the direction of, we're carnivores because we're meant to be eating fat, right? The reason we've been told not to eat animals and not to eat plants is because they have fat. But that's actually very obviously that we should be doing that, because we have four organs working together in order to make it possible to absorb fat, okay? And we have very low pH stomach acid. And this is a side note, so a lot of people will get better digestion if you don't drink water sort of 2 hours before or after a meal, because you keep that stomach acid more concentrated, so you'll break food down better, okay? So we've got very concentrated pH, okay? We've got a long, small intestine. We've got a short, large intestine. We have a vestigial appendix, not a cecum. We can't break down fiber. We've got four organs working to absorb fat, okay? You can argue day and night about the anatomy of these things, and I'm sure someone has a rebuttal to why I'm completely wrong, even though they're wrong, but it comes down to functionality. We don't break down fiber at all. Period. Okay. So it's really hard for us to process any plant material at all that contains fiber. Okay. We break down, liquefy, and absorb meat very easily. Even infants in studies in the 1950s were showing that when being fed meat for the first time, or anything for the first time, they were being given meat, they would absorb 98% of what they were given. Okay. Dr. Salisbury of the Salisbury steak, he made the Salisbury steak specifically because you ground the meat in a very specific way to get the gristle out, and you just had the muscle meat and you just had the fat. You didn't have the gristle and the connective tissue, and they were finding you absorbed basically 100% of that. And so people that had very serious digestive issues, like, you know, Crohn's and ulcerative colitis and so forth, and it was 100 years before we had any treatments for this. You know, these people had horrible digestions. They had extreme pain. They were had bloody diarrhea constantly every day. And so these people really needed to rest their bowels and so forth. And so that's why Salisbury came up with the Salisbury steak. So this had like zero residue, and they could just rest. And this is what we do in surgery as well for the, you know, the general surgeons. When you have diverticulitis, appendicitis that you're not treating surgically, you're treating conservatively, you will rest the bowel by giving them a low fiber diet. You know, if fiber is so good for your digestion, so good for your intestine, why do we need to get rid of it when we're resting your bowel? You know, that should make you ask questions. Now, maybe there's an instance that holds true, but you know, it should make you wonder, if this is so good for your body, wouldn't you want it when your body's trying to heal that exact organ? No, in fact, there are studies that show that the only, you know, correlation between, you know, eating and all these sorts of things and diverticulosis, which is the outpouching, the failure of the distal colon, that can then get infected and so forth and get diverticulitis and cause you big problems. The only things that were associated with increased rates of diverticulosis were increased number of bowel motions a day, increased fiber intake, okay? But you're overworking the organ. You're making this work, and it finally just fails, just like heart failure. You're pumping against a high gradient, a high pressure all the time, and after several years, you know, it just wears out and you get failure. Well, this is colon failure, okay? And that's because you're overusing it, you're overworking it, okay? Whereas if you eat a low residue diet, like a carnivore diet, where you're not eliminating waste all that often because there's no waste to eliminate, right? Then, you know, that doesn't go into failure. You know, and that just another thing, you know, I say that, you know, you can't really digest meat that just stays in your intestine and rots for years. If anybody thought about that for more than 1 second, they would realize that's insane, because your digestion is a tube. It's a one-way tube. It just goes out. And so if you weren't digesting this, you'd just be crapping out lumps of meat every day, but you don't. You crap out lumps of wood, which is fiber. That's what we're excreting, and we're being told, oh, no, but that's good for you. We absorb this so easily, and yet we don't absorb it at all. We don't break it down at all, okay? We cannot break down the fundamental structure of plants, which is fiber. We break down and absorb basically 100% of animal tissue. So I hope that was informative. I hope you guys liked that. And let me know in the comments what other sorts of videos you'd like to hear about. Take care.